So good evening all of you. I welcome to this 2-day online course on journal selection. This is a pre-recorded video. In case if the electricity cuts off or if it does not go as we think, then this would be given to all the participants. Here I have discussed everything that you need as part of the contents of the day one. Right. So a little bit about myself. My name is Chandan Taluja. Right now I'm doing my PhD at CSIR, CSIU Delhi Center. My specialization includes machine learning and wireless sensor networks. Till now I have written more than 10 research articles and given various talks about real world interfacing and academic writing. So a little bit about the contents of the day one. So as a part of the day one, we are going to talk about the types of the journals. Then we'll go to the ISBN, DOI and impact factor. What are these things? Then I'll tell you how you can select a journal. Then I'll tell you the tricks by which you can identify a predatory journal. Then whenever you're going to select a journal, one of the things that matters the most is the impact factor or the SCJR factor. But most of us don't have that idea about how much impact factor is good enough for a journal in order to select a journal. So we'll talk about that. Then we'll talk about how to check the indexing of the journal. Here in this recorded video, I'll talk only about the theory. But if we do it live or if we do it at the part of day two, I will check each and every journal that you will give me. So whichever journal you want me to check to verify that whether it is right one or not, I will be doing it right here in front of you as a part of day two. Then we'll talk about what to do after you have selected a journal. What are the steps? So these are the contents as a part of the day one. So let's get started. So first of all, what are the types of the journals? There are three types. First is the limited access journal. Second is the open access journal. And third is a predatory journal. In any case, you have to keep yourself safe from a predatory journal so that you don't get fall to trap of this. What you can do is go for a first or the second option is the limited access or open access journals. So first of all, we will talk about limited access journals. So these are those where we do not have to pay in order to publish a research article. They have intensive peer review. For those who don't know what is a peer review, so see, every journal has its scope, and according to that scope they have a group of experts, and the task of those experts is to see that whichever article comes for that journal, it should match the quality of that journal. So your article is sent to that group of experts of the same field, right? And then they give you comments. This whole process is called as peer review. Since journal has to maintain its quality, like if you have subscribed to a specific theme or a specific journal of some specific theme, you are paying for that, right? So you expect that every time you get better quality articles, and this is the job of the editor. So editor and those group, and then editor maintains that list of those experts. Then editor and those experts, they both work together in order to maintain the quality work. Like only the quality articles should come and get submitted to that journal. So they have quite intensive peer review. And in the case of limited access journals, the readers pay the money to access the manuscript. You might have seen that whenever you open a journal, there is some kind of lock or they ask for some money. So that is a limited access journal. In those, readers have to pay in order to read the manuscript. The authors do not have to pay in that case. We also call this as a free journal. So as you can see here, this is a snapshot of a journal. and here you can see on those articles they have this line called as or this symbol called as purchase PDF. So this goes for what? Like if you really want to read that journal, you have to give some money. So this is what I was talking. This is a limited access journal, right? So the second is open access journal. In this case, the publishing cost is given by the authors. Here again, they have a intensive peer review. In this case, the readers do not have to pay anything, right? So like limited access journals, here again they have to maintain that quality, so they keep that intensive peer review, but the cost here is given by the authors. Then as you can see, this is a snapshot of a website called as DOAG. So this stands for Directory of Open Access Journals. So this website maintains a list of all those open access journals through subjects. So next time when you want to find out a journal which is open access and you wanted to send it there, then you can search through this website. So as you can see here in your screen, here is one of the snapshots of some open access website. As you can see that the link is open, this lock is open, and they have a way to access the PDF of the manuscript. So this, through this you can get an idea that this is an open access and you can easily read this article. Now coming on to the predatory journals, here they do not have any peer review process. They may charge you some money or they may not. It is totally depending upon them, but in most of the cases they charge you some amount of money in order to get your article published, and then they have a beers list of predatory journals. So this is an online list where they maintain, where they have the names of all those journals which are fake. So whenever you are going to search for a journal, whenever you are going to finalize a journal that okay, I want to send my article to this journal, just check its name in this list that if it is there or not, right? Now coming, so this is a snapshot of BL's list. So whenever you are going to publish a journal, to submit your article to a journal, just once check the name of that journal in this list. Now you might have heard about these matrices ISBN, DOI, impact factor. So we are going to talk about all of this. So when you publish a chapter in a book, right? So every book has its ISBN number, every journal has its ISSN number, right? And every article has a DOI number. So this is how they identify. See, and for every authors there is an ORC ID, ORCID ID, it's called as. So why do we need this? Why do we need an ISBN number? Why do we need an ISSN number, DOI number or ORC ID? See, there my name is Chandan. So there might be many more authors with the same name, right? Like if I publish a chapter in a book, then that book, the same title of that book might be of the others also, right? So that's why they need a specific number for a book, for a journal, so that it can be identified even though it may or may not have a same name as those of others. So ISBN number is for books. ISBN stands for International Standard Book Number. So here they give every book a universal ID, which makes it easy for bookstores, libraries, readers and publishers to find and refer to your book. So ISBN is for books. And so one shortcoming is for ISBN is that it does not provide information on all the versions of the particular book. See, we have the editions also, right? Because the next edition book may have its own unique code. So you might not be able to know that whether do we have a new edition of this book or not. So this is one of the shortcomings of the ISBN. Then ISBN is of 13 digits and it contains 5 types of informations or the elements as we say. So first is a prefix. Then we have a registration group. Then we have a registrant, the publication, and lastly a checksum. So I will be showing you an example of all of this so you have a better idea. So as you can see here, this is an example of an ISBN number that you can see behind any book. So this is in the form of a barcode, right? So first three numbers, right? This is the ISBN 13 prefix, right? So then this is what we call as a group or country identifier. Then we have a publisher identifier after this. Then we have an ID for the title. Then we have a title identifier. And the last is what we call as a checksum, or which is used to check if the ISBN number is correct or not. So this is how they make an ISBN number, and this is how you can check and identify an ISBN number. Now coming on to the DOI number, since I said ISBN is for books, ISSN is for articles, and DOI ISSN is for journals, and DOI is for articles, every research article. So this is used by in scientific journals. Each article in those journals will have its own DOI. DOI stands for what? Digital Object Identifier, right? So an example of DOI, as you can see, this is an example of DOI. So now we'll have a look on what is introduced, on what constitutes a DOI. So first, the numbers are of the publisher. So this number stands for whom? Wiley. Then this J indicates what? That this is a journal article. Then we have the ISSN number of the journal. Then we have the year in which this journal actually came out. And then we have an article tracking number. So this is what makes a DOI number in this case. Now when you are going to select a journal, what are the things that you need to look for? First is the theme, aim, scope, all of these things. Why I'm telling you that this is the first thing that you need to see, that even if you select a journal which has a good impact factor, even if you select a journal which has a good indexing, but if the theme, aim or scope of your article is not going to match with that of a journal, your article is bound to get rejected no matter what you do. So theme, aim and scope is the first thing that you need to see when you are going to select a journal. Once your theme, aim and scope matches, so this is the step one. Once this matches, then only you can go ahead to the step two. The step two is the indexing. See, if the journal is indexed in SCI or above science, then it will have an impact factor. But if your article is indexed with Scopus, it will have an SCJR factor. SCJR stands for what? Schimago Country Journal Ranking. Then the third thing that you have to see is site score. We will be talking about impact factor, site score, all of this as an individual topics. The third thing that you have to see is time for first decision. So what does time for first decision actually means? When you have submitted your article in a journal, right? Then it takes some time for the first time to tell you that whether they are going to accept your article or not, right? That time is called as time for first decision. And the fifth thing that you have to see is, are there any open access charges? If there are, then whether will you be able to pay that fees or not? If not, then you might have to go for some other journal. So as I said, that when if you have a, if there are three types of indexings in our country. First is CoScopus, then is the Web of Science, and the third one is UGC care list. So I'll tell you what, if you're doing your PhD, try to go for Scopus or Web of Science. But if you are working as a faculty somewhere, if you're working as an assistant professor or associate professor, then always check with your institute. What are the guidelines of this institute? Whether they want a journal which is UGC care list indexed, or whether they want for a Web of Science or Scopus, right? So the Scopus is maintained by the Scopus data, and the Web of Science is maintained by Thomson Reuters. So what does indexing actually means, right? So indexing are some set of indexing companies have some set of rules, like Thomson Reuters and Scopus. They have some set of rules like on the quality, on the regularity of publication. They have some set of rules that if a journal maintains and follows those set of rules, then that journal is indexed by those indexing services. Your article is not indexed, that your article is in a journal, that journal is indexed by Scopus or SCI or UGC care list. If it is indexed by SCI or Web of Science, then it will have an impact factor. But if it is indexed by Scopus, then it will have an SCJR factor. SCJR, what? Scopus journal ranking factor. Now, once when you have, when you know that, so the first step, as I said, the first step is what? Your theme, aim and scope should match. Once that matches, you have to make this table right here in front of you. Write the name of the journal, write about it, about its indexing, write about its impact factor, then what is the time for first review of that journal, and cost of open access, if any. So once you have this table for like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 journals, so this table is going to help you in two ways. First of all, once when you have 3, 4 journals in front of you, where you can try and send your article, then it makes you easy, because you have these factors which will help you to decide where you can firstly send your article. See, if you have four names here, then you can make your own preferences that, okay, first I will try to send at this journal, then second to this, then third to this, then fourth to this. So now you have a list, a customized list for you, right? Then let us suppose, even if from first journal it gets rejected, so now you again don't have to sit and find a journal. You automatically have the name of your journal where you can send it as your second preference. So this list is going to help you a lot and save your time, first of all, to selecting a journal, and if you get a rejection from any journal, then in order to go for the second one. Now, as you know, that we have to save ourselves from predatory or fake journals. So how you are going to do that? First of all, cross check the name of that journal with the indexing database. Like, see, if the journal says that the journal is indexed with SCI, right, or the Web of Science, then go ahead and check the name on the indexing website also. Everything should be same, even the name should be same, even the spelling should be same, if there is an and in the name of that journal, then even that and should match. Very first criteria is this, right? Second, you can investigate the editorial board, like just check the name of the editor in chief, and editor in chief might be working in some university at some place, something like that. Then you can even go to the website of that university and match the name there, that whether this person actually works at that university or not. The third thing, the contact email should not be Gmail. If it is, put it aside. Then the fees policy. Fees policy, if there is no fees, it should be mentioned on the website. If it is not, then just email the editor and ask it from them. And the next thing that you can do in order to save yourselves from predatory or fake journals is the BLS list. Just check the name of the journal in the BLS list, if it matches or not. If it does, if you can find the name, then that itself is a fake journal. Now, impact factor. As I said, what is an impact factor? So, impact factor is a cytometric index that tells you about the yearly average of citations of the articles that were published in that journal got in the last 2 years. Like, if we are going to find out the impact factor for 2020, then we'll have a look at how many articles were published in the last 2 years, in 2018 and 2019. Then we'll do a sum of those numbers, like if they have 300 articles in 2018 and 200 articles in 2019. So total number of articles that were published in the last 2 years comes out to what? 500, right? I'm typing with mouse. Now, having a look at the citations. Like, in 2018, the 300 articles that were published in those journals, let us suppose it got 20 citations. In the next year, these 200 articles, they got what, 30 citations. This is just a reference or the some example that I'm showing you. So what is the total number of citations in those 2 years? It's 50. So what comes out to be the impact factor when we divide? It is 0.1. So this is how they find out the impact factor of a journal. Let me tell you one more time, impact factor is never for the article. It is always for the journal. Your article is published in a journal which is indexed by SCI and has an impact factor of whatever. So the next thing, site score. Site score is somewhat similar to that of impact factor. Here also it reflects the yearly average number of citations, but here instead of going for the last 2 years, we check for the last 3 years. So if somebody is going to measure the site score for 2020, then they have to look at the metrics, the number of citations that they have got in the last 3 years, 17, 19 and 20. So, talking about how much is a good impact factor when you are going to select a journal. See, when we are talking about medical journals, then they have a huge number of citations at every article. So, for medical journals, the average impact factor goes to around 40 to 50 range. While when we are talking about engineering or sciences journals, then even for management ones, then it goes to the range of 6 to 8. and when we are going to talk about mathematical journals, then it goes for the range of 2 to 3 impact factor. So there cannot be a specific range or specific criteria for all the research areas, but I can tell you a good number of impact factors. See, when you are going to publish your first article, if it is the first article that you are going to publish, always try for a journal which has less than one impact factor, because there it will be somewhat easier for you in the beginning if you go ahead for this. But if you are going after you have done like 4 or 5 articles in the SCI or Scopus, then you can go for 4 to 5 impact factor journals. So this is what you can do. And how you are going to compare, like if there is no common criteria, always compare those journals which are of same research area. Like, don't go ahead and compare an agriculture journal with a humanities journal. If you're going to compare, make sure that they both are of same research area, right? And also, when you are going to compare those journals, see that they both should have same focus. And now, what should you be doing after you have selected a journal? When you have, like, since here I showed you a table, like you have selected, like, okay, I want to first send my article in this journal. So now, what are the steps that you have to follow after you have selected your journal? That's what we are going to talk as of now. So first of all, share the name of the journal with your guide or your supervisor. Why? Your guide knows your work, right? They have checked your article. They know what kind of journal would be best for your article. So one of the suggestions that I have for you is to share this table with your guide or your supervisor and tell them that this is the journal where I want to send my article first and then go to the next ones. So they have a better idea about this than you. So they can tell you that your selection or your choice is good enough or not. So the first thing that you have to do after you have selected a journal is to take permissions from your supervisor and the other authors. Like, just send a mail with your manuscript that, okay, this is my manuscript and I want to send this manuscript to this journal. Will you allow me or not? Do you permit me to do so or not? The second thing, like if you get any comment from the authors, from your guide or from your supervisor that this can be done in this way and this can be done in this way, then you have to make changes according to the comments that they have shared. The third thing, formatting. Like, every journal has their own specifications. Like, this is what the font size, this is the spacing, this is how you are going to make a table, and this is how you are going to make an figure. So you have to format your manuscript as your journal. Like, don't worry about formatting while you are writing your manuscript. That time you can write as whatever as you want. But when you are going to actually submit it, then you have to take care of all of this. The next thing, then you have to complete all of the articles that you need, all of the documents that you need to submit your paper. Like, you have to sign a form from all your authors, you have to write a cover letter, all those things. Do that, complete all those things. And finally, you have to submit your manuscript after you have done all these things. And also, one more thing, check the plagiarism. The plagiarism should be less than 10%. for most of the scopus and SCI, they try for less than 5% also, but in your case it should never be greater than 10%. So this brings us to the end of the day one of this session. If you have any doubt, just put it in the WhatsApp group. I will be there to answer your queries, and tomorrow's time will be announced soon. In the meantime, just take care, and this video will be shared with all of you. If there is an electricity cut and if the things go well, then I will be taking the session live for all of you. Take care.